Thank you very much, honorable members, for your previous contributions. We acknowledge today is a new dawn in the history of our educational system we have, especially in the tertiary education. We are so happy for His Excellency, the President. She said in his presidential statement, human capital development is not a political slogan. We have to go after it. It's the only way we can change our nation. It's the only way we can transform this country from where we are and to a better place for the 21st century. It's education you can use to transform people. It's education you can use to keep tribalism. It's education you can use to accept the social contract you have with you and your people. What is the social contract? As government, our social contract is our manifesto. Our colleagues, our members, today accepted. In my speech, Mr. Speaker, I said, let us judge President Liu on his social contract.
Yes.
That is what we should do.
Yes.
And I told the members of the fourth estate, go after him. Do investigative journalism. Today, these are some of the things I've been talking about. I'm happy he's making us proud. All of us are Australians. Right across the eye, we are real people. As I said, Mr. Speaker, philosophically, only positive thinkers bring solutions to solve their problems in society. Because you represent societal problems, that's why we are President Liu. He has the hindsight. I repeat my words. He has the hindsight. So it's not by any mistake to have a professor alcohol. By no mistake, he have given you a whole lot of accolades and praises. But for me, I'm a mentor. He lectured me chemistry when I went to private college. But what I observed is that environmental and educational gene cloning you are having. From your free father, from your father, and you today. We are this type of education by behavior. You have now really associated yourself with the educational system. And you are an academic material, I can tell you for free. You are an academic doctor. So keep to that client. It's not by any stretch that she said the Alpha is going to do it again. It's a new dawn. It's a history. All of us, we are making a new history. We have heard about the generality of members talking about how they suffered when they came to private college, Jala University, etc. But that is what has happened in the past. In this new system, the new direction, we say let us take a new pathway to civilian trajectory. Today, that is the general aspect. I listened to a doctor, PhD, at Mithi Magai, because you have mentioned a lot of things about Mithi Magai, because they have been yearning for it for far too long. So I want to link myself with Professor Kuwama, who gave a public lecture, a speech doctor. I followed him carefully. I read some of the contributions. He gave a public lecture to hospice. And one of the things that I want us to look at to this educational sector, which he highlighted. Mr. Speaker, bear with me. I need to say this because human capital development itself is not a slogan. It's not a political tool. It is the way we want to change this business of struggling. Mr. Speaker, I will read the provision he made. In page 5, let me read what he said. He was trying to define management training and human capital development. He said the last element that is central to a university of technology is management training and the development of human capital. In the development of so-called industrialized countries, an absence of sophisticated management capacity translates into poor use of existing technology and existing skills, and therefore a failure to understand and manage the acquisition of capabilities and opportunities to grow. It is indeed for this reason that MIT, today we are talking about America, one of the world's leading universities of technology, has world-class business at its heart. Believe me, Mr. Speaker, I've read this one now. Members, we are talking about technology, and for you to develop in science, but the basis of science, there are three factors we have in the basis of science: chemistry, biology, and physics. That's the basis. So we need science education. So in doing science education, we have to talk about the curriculum that you have to develop so that you can match with the 21st century. We have failed in three of the industrial generations. So we failed in the first industrial revolution generation. We failed in the second industrial revolution. We failed in the third. But the fourth industrial revolution, in terms of development technology, we cannot afford to fail. It has to do with digital transformation. It has to do with technology. It has to be a highly industrialized country. That you have the United States, you have the Western world. That has to do with advanced system of advanced development in terms of industry. So he highlighted all of those things, and we are also following that path that we need to follow so that we can catch up with the 21st, with the fourth revolution in terms of industrial development. So because we are failing the first, second, and third. But Mr. Speaker, honorable members, why we should make sure we don't fail? We don't fail because we have the available knowledge. If we have the available knowledge, we are not looking for partnership in the business of science and technology. Look for partnership. We look for the available technologies we have. We look for the policies, the right policies that we put in place, and leadership. We look for leadership and incentives. You cannot talk about science and technology, talk about university coming up without talking about incentives. And if we put all of this together, we have a very comfortable floor from what you are coming from. Because of that system, we have been able and we have put in place all of the structures we have today in our educational system, which are put forward to this house in the form of a bill so that we can understand and take a path with the trajectory we are with. It's good for us to understand the context of the university itself from the bill. But before we get there, let me again reference the learned Dr. Patrick. He said, and I will join that one with what we have in the policy fiscal statement. Well, that we also, that is before this house, doing the budget hearing. The physical strategy statement, which is a form of policy, it gives us a projection that if we want to succeed in the business of putting across our developing strides, the GDP we are talking about, domestic revenue mobilization, in 2019 to 2023, we should have it at 20% of GDP. That is what we should do. Why? Because if we increase the domestic mobilization in terms of expenditure, that's the only way we can support our own projects, like education. We talk about human development capital, we are talking about put a lot of finances in it. So that is good. So he mentioned that one. He has to align the development strike in his educational business because it has to do with funding. So he mentioned that one. That it's not anything like you have to do in your own comfortable area. It's you have to go after to get funding, incentives, and other things. So let me quote him again. Mr. Speaker, honorable members. In page 2 of what he said, in paragraph 2, page 11. He is giving both the plausible side of the educational structure we have, and also looking at the disadvantage side. So looking at the guy is optimistic and guy is pessimistic. He's putting up across. So he said, let me read his words. He said, not the numbers, but he's talking about the quality. While there is need for more universities, that is of technology, to accommodate a growing number of youth that are aspiring for university education, I will caution against establishing one such university in search of the five regions. In search of the five regions. You're giving us caution. You are giving us extensive explanation on why we need it. In the regions, if such are to be funded by the government. So that's why I made reference to the domestic revenue mobilization, making projections from the and the budget statement that we have in front of us, making projections that we should increase our domestic revenue mobilization 20% of our GDP come 2023. If we have to put these policies, and the government has to put in place funds to support these universities, it will be a challenge. That is the reality. But he further went on to say, although there is a will, the huge financial support provided by government and the strain on the budget for the universities, it's a point to work on considering seriously. It is a fact that resources in many African countries or universities are really overstretched. We are suffering from this now. I thank my colleague on the other side. During the debate, she asked, that's why I put in place, I said, the policy statement by the Minister of Finance talking about domestic revenue mobilization, GDP. And today, I understand your position when you talk about the link of we university. The link of we university. Today there is trouble, there is a problem there. But the government came in and gave some funding.
Yeah.
But it's not being captured. It has not been captured in the form of a deal that you have in the law. So what they did, they decided to give a bill out of 2 billion. But that is not be an enough. If you put at what they have done in this deal is to capture that particular problem they have. They have experienced with the Bowie University. So but you know, as I said, Mr. Minister, one of the things that we need to do is not to kill an entity. The aspiration, the spirit of that particular entity is to get more people educated in terms of technology, science, technology. What you are pushing for now, how do we sustain? How do we sustain the economy? How do we sustain the economy? That is what we should do. So in that provision, if you go to clause 43 of the deal, let me just take you there, I don't remember. 43, if you start with 42 and 43, I just want to talk to the bill so we can understand what you are doing. Page 43, I read this one specifically for the purpose of Lincoln-We and why, with your vision, they have decided to capture it in a particular bill. The caption is establishment of private university. If you go on at the university itself in clause 2, you realize that they are talking about two sets of universities. That is public university that has to do with the government structure and the private university that we are talking about in Congo. We feature on 43 of his speech. A person, 43.3, Mr. Chairman, Mr. Speaker, 43.3. A person who wishes to establish a private university shall apply to the commission with the particulars of the company referred to in subsection 1. And a business plan showing the object of the company as a university and the resources available for its operations. This one can also fall within the ones that we have. If you go back to the schedule, what do you remember? Okay, people are there highlighted and said a lot about the business. So we are happy, we are glamouring all over the place. We are going to have university, we have Primary College, we have Alan University, we have Anabel Kuma. We have Bitimaga University of Education and Technology. We are hooked to have beside the Technical University of Sierra Leone. We have the Kenema campus, Banama campus. We have the University of Science and Technology, the Kono campus. The question we ask ourselves, our financially, in terms of resources, are we ready? So you highlighted that one. So that's why I cited Dr. Patrick. He said, in as much as we are yearning the aspiration for young people who want to go to university, we are yearning to have more university around us. And in the 5 regions we are talking about, we need to talk about finances. If we are going to depend on government funding alone, the university will collapse.
Yes.
So because it's very difficult to sustain universities. So I made reference deliberately to the strategic policy statement made by the Ministry of Finance. For us to increase, there is a need for us to increase our domestic revenue mobilization in terms of GDP to all 2023. And the projection I'm drawing attention to. Today we are talking about single-digit inflation under the macroeconomic budget performance. It has to do alignment. It has to do with the single-digit inflation we have achieved. But it's not going to be at the end of. If we follow some of these principles, economic principles, we can succeed in what we are about to do here today. It's not to make pronouncements, Mr. Minister, but for us to succeed, sustainability is our educational structure. I said it's not a slogan. It's not a slogan at all. Mr. Speaker, honorable member, for us, we want to maintain some standards in the educational system. Standards. You know, he talking about the curriculum, when the President mentioned about Mr. Speaker, I wrap up very soon. I don't want to do something. Mr. Speaker, honorable members, the credibility of our university is very key. The credibility. He went to Cambridge and he went to good universities. The seal of every university is very important. We are not going to water down standard because we want to university in Tibagai, university in Kenema, we don't want to water down the standard. In as much as we are talking about developing the curriculum in various universities, those curricula we are going to develop, Mr. Speaker. It will be very significant for us to understand this. Because in the secondary education that we are talking about quality, that want to discern the quality of education from tertiary to our secondary schools. It has to do with radical reforms. And the radical reform has to do with how we train our teachers, maintain standards, know what are now standards. So that's what the curriculum developed.
With discipline.
It has to do with the curriculum development, Mr. Speaker, honorable member. So I call on you.
It's not controversial. So why keep us for long?
Can you give me a few minutes, honorable? I need to react to you. Mr. Minister, I am bringing your attention so that we can maintain standards. Because even in this deal, the way you treat people in terms of if you want to fire your staff members, there is what we call the principle of natural justice. And there is so much entrenching to people, students. We have to see this relationship. Students, school, lecturers, school, junior staff association. We need to have that relationship. You know why? To maintain the free flow of the universities. You maintain the relationship. Because that's the only way it works. So that we can succeed in the business of education. In those days where you are concerned, there's a big gap between the student and lecturer relationship. But in this bill, they seek to address all of the structures we have put in place to create a relationship between the student, the lecturers, with that of the junior staff. Without the junior staff, there's no way you are going to succeed. We want them to support the staff. Mr. Speaker, honorable member, as I said, I want the students to read. I want the students, Mr. Minister, honorable minister, for them to read this particular bill that you are going to pass into law. After the enactment of this bill, they need to read it. Because for you to even increase fees, there is a way you are going about it. For you to discipline students from the Senate, you have to be the platform to students to defend themselves. So I talk about the natural justice system, put in pay in the university. There is total challenge in this bill that has to do with discrimination. You cannot discriminate because I'm saying you are lecturing me, you belong to a different political party, I'm in party A, you try to discriminate. There is a platform for that. Mr. Minister, thank you very much. As I said, I don't take environmental pruning in terms of education, but you really know how to go about the education structure. To look at the present circumstance, how do we solve the problem by law? Not by manufacturing it. We can only distinguish between us and Chipali in the jungle, as I said, by the rule of law. And that's why we are enshrining this one in the bill. And so we are going to look at that. And I encourage all the students that are going to benefit for the creation of this university to read this one. So read the provision embedded in the particular act and bill that you are going to enact. And Mr. Speaker, honorable members, we talk about the gender policy. A few minutes ago, last week, we are discussing gender policy. You know what you have done? I have just highlighted talking about the rule of the natural justice system, the protection of students, that is, the student, lecturer, junior staff relationship. They are going to be in most of the committees that you are going to form, even in terms of accommodation. Students are going to be part of the committees. Because this is the 21st century, we want to have a sanitized university, not the draconian ones we had. During the 80s, the 70s, we don't do things the way we feel. These are modern times. So, in that direction, what you have done, I'll come out of the house, what you have done is to look at affirmative action for women. I can take one. If you go to part 5, cross 11, if you go to part 5, that's page 12. Let me read one cluster you put in place, Mr. Minister. It's a very good one. Honor the court, senate, and committees of the university. This is very important for us because we are coming from where in the dark ages where people deprived our women not to go to school. And today, if you want to transform that one, you will recognize that one. Even in the university, we need to recognize that the ladies who are working in the university need to be protected. And they need to be in a particular committee. Not because you have to put them there, because they should take affirmative action. And let me read the provision you give. Clause 2, page 12. B, each representative of the Senate nominated by the Chancellor would advise from the Minister in charge of technical and higher education four of whom shall be the woman. So it's a mandatory clause given. You should follow me. Mr. Speaker, honorable members, as you said, we have just highlighted some of these areas that we think we can make reference to. It is good for us to understand why we need to follow the trend of education in our system, in changing the landscape of our human development capital, but also look at what we do in terms of conforming ourselves to the rule of law. That's why we are giving this provision a lot of affirmative action given to women, so that in setting up of committees, this affirmative action can be recognized and put in.
Point of order, my brother, if you may. Honorable leader.